lights start flashing.
How many we got? One, two, three, four, five, six.
So we just got a couple on votes.
Yeah, on the thin deck, all right. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the Tuesday, November 15th, Planning and Zoning Commission meeting for Wethersfield. Tony, would you give us the roll call?
Sure. Chairman, Mr. Harlan.
I am here.
Vice Chairman Margiotta here. Clerk Roberts absent. Members Jim Hughes absent. George Oikel.
Here.
Hammer absent. O'Mickey.
Here.
Tom Dean absent. Allard absent. Edwards. Antoniak.
Yep.
And Dan Silver.
Here.
All righty, so there are six of us. We all are participating. The first item, 3.1, an application 1930-16-Z, seeking a special permit in accordance with Section 3.6, Accessory Buildings and Structures. Regulations for a garage exceeding 18 feet at 336 Jordan Lane. Is the applicant here? Would you join us at the microphone and start by introducing yourself and an address, and then give us a brief description of your request?
Jaworski, reside at 336 Jordan Lane, and I would like to build an accessory garage that's taller than what's allowed, so I'd like to have it at 22 feet tall, under 8 feet square feet.
All right. Thank you. Peter, you gave us a memo, and it was pretty straightforward.
Yes, the only wrinkle is this property, believe it or not, is in a multifamily zone. Obviously, a garage is permitted in a multifamily zone, but it just adds an additional wrinkle to the application. The surrounding property on Folly Brook is SRD zoned, and this property is also SRD zoned. It's a relatively straightforward application. The applicant also obtained approvals, and I believe it was in your packet, from the Inland Wetlands and Water Courses Commission back on October 19th. They approved the application. The site does have wetlands and is also located in a flood zone, so he had to work those issues out with the Inland Wetlands Commission. They did approve it. There's correspondence dated October 20th of this year with the condition, revise the location of silt fence and show erosion controls immediately below the stockpile area. So they added some stipulations that he will have to live with as part of the construction sequencing. There was a memo related to that application also in your packet. It was dated September 21st from Town Engineer Gregor, in case you're interested in that. There is a memo also, as you mentioned, from planning staff, which in essence summarizes the application. So the specific provisions that are not complied with are the height of the accessory building, as was indicated by the applicant, is 22 feet in height. If there is any lighting, we would ask that the lighting comply with your lighting standards of Section 6.7. Otherwise, the proposal complies with the regulations. We did not, I don't believe, receive any inquiries, any phone calls, anything like that from neighbors. There is in the file evidence that the certificates of mailing were provided to the surrounding neighbors, so that is evident in the file.
How many were there, neighbors?
Quite a few. Let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
It's a long, there's a lot of neighbors.
There's probably
notify a lot of people.
50.
Probably 50 something, yep.
Yeah.
Yep. So there is a site plan in your file, which and some building plans, which provide a little bit of detail about the accessory structure.
Thank you. Questions for the applicant?
Oh.
Really? Surprise? George?
Well, I asked. I guess these questions of him.
Go ahead.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Who owns the right of way? You, right? Yeah. A long right of way.
Sorry?
Holy cow. What is it, about a half a mile?
It's 1,000 feet. It's from Jordan Lane to my house. My property is 1,000 feet. And you got about, I would say, 2,000 feet the other direction. So about 3,000 feet, so it's about...
Yeah, it goes, you really, you cleared back quite a bit, but not all the way back to the right-of-way to...
Well, it goes all the way to the...
What is it?
Harbor line.
The other right, outlet there that you don't use.
It goes all the way to Harbor line.
Yeah, yeah. The garage, how's it gonna be used? Just for your residential vehicles?
Yeah.
Okay, and I noticed another...
My house is only, it's under 900 square feet, so I don't have much room there if I, you know, I put anything in. And I have an acre of land, so I have a lawnmower, I have a tractor, I have a big snow machine. I have an acre of land, there's a lot of, you know, a lot of things I...
Well, you got a 1,000-foot driveway, you gotta have some equipment, right?
Besides the driveway, I'm just the land itself.
And plus the land itself, yeah, a lot of land.
Straight, it's 3/4 acre and it turns at the corner, 1/4 acre. So, yeah. The garage itself, it's gonna be 840 square feet, it's only just two driveways, so it's just two cars, you know?
How do you maintain that driveway? It seemed kinda undulating. I'm just kinda curious.
And it's snow?
Well, it's snow, yeah, you gotta plow it.
I have a heavy-duty snow machine, I gotta go four times, you know, so...
Yeah.
4,000 feet walking, you know?
Yeah, it's probably a wet soil back there, so I imagine would require some gravel and stuff, yeah. I think that's it, Mr. Chairman, I believe. Yeah, I just, your use of the garage is just, you're not trying to do anything commercial back there or anything like that. By the way, there was an unregistered vehicle, why in the, we don't allow it in town.
I'm sorry?
So, just comment to you on that.
I'm sorry?
He noticed an unregistered vehicle.
Unregistered vehicle, that's all.
I have one, I have two, one is mine, which I'm actually converting to a camper, and one is my, my parents' car. They have to sell their car to get this one as a camper.
Okay, basically, Mr....
Both my cars, one is gonna be my camper, which I'm gonna do.
Basically, Mr. Chairman, this is only a garage, and there's not a big issue with it.
And I, it would appear that you're trying to get the extra few feet so that you can have walking space upstairs?
That's what I would like to have, it's just to have nice little attic space, 'cause the gentleman with the trusses company, he showed me a few examples of trusses, and then he showed me the one with the extra attic space.
Yep.
And he told me if I want that, then it's gotta, I'm gonna have to get, you know, a couple, 3-4 feet extra.
And how tall is the house? Is it a single?
It's a single house, it's...
It's a single floor, or is it?
No, just one floor, yeah, basement and the floor, and just one floor.
Looks like the garage will be bigger, taller anyway.
That's...
About the same height?
Yeah, because the house, I mean, the floor starts, you know?
Peter, how does the comp, this comp area, that's one of my questions here. How does it work? They dig out a hole?
So they have to, it's basically, in essence, they have to balance out the amount of fill in the flood zone so that the storage capacity is maintained as it exists today, or better, if that can happen.
They dig out a piece of that.
So they fill, and then they have to compensate on the other side, that's the...
That doesn't make it a nice, smooth area for him to take care of, though.
Mostly for the foundation, I'm gonna bring probably like, you know, I forgot what the number was, about 25 or so yards of concrete, and it's like to compensate that, whatever comes in, it's gotta go out.
That's right, yeah, okay.
They don't want any, if it floods, they don't want the water go somewhere else, it's gotta stay there.
So you gotta compensate for that, pushing that additional material back there, okay, yeah. But is it, it's not gonna be a big hole back there?
No, it's just a...
They're gonna spread it out somehow.
It's minor grading, I would...
Even though it shows, okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Tony?
You have city sewer and city water on this site?
Septic.
You have septic?
Mm-hmm.
Is that on the print, or is it farther back from the house, or on the other side?
It's back to the house.
Okay. And the lighting issue's not a concern? You won't have any plumbing or anything in the garage? And Peter, I guess he meets the setbacks and sidelines?
Well, because it's a garage, it can be as close as 5 feet to the, but he's got 20 feet on one side, and then over 30 feet on the other side.
Dziękuję.
What'd you say?
I said thank you.
Oh, okay. Any other questions for the applicant? If not, it is a public hearing. Take a motion.
Motion to close public hearing.
Thank you, thank you. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? All right, so, motion on the application itself? Anybody? Dan?
Seems like a very straightforward application. It's a nice design. I think that it fits within the neighborhood. It meets our requirements for a special permit, and I'm in favor of it.
Do you make a motion to approve 1930?
Yeah, I'll make a motion, although, before I do.
Make a motion, yeah.
I'm going to make a motion to approve the application with the conditions set forth by staff.
Second. I want to say about this. Something I was going to bring up, but I forgot. It's all right.
Okay. All right, so we have a motion to approve and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Is there anybody opposed? All right, so six positives. Good luck. Ready? All right, item number two. There isn't an item. Well, there is. Other business already. So discussion regarding Zoning Board of Appeals application 6183, request for a use variance for a permit for a church, in an agricultural zone. We had something in the package here. This is from, what did we get it from, Justin?
Justin, yes.
Justin.
That's why Justin is here tonight.
All right, Justin. You want to summarize it for us?
So essentially what this is, the applicant is requesting a use variance through the Zoning Board of Appeals. They'd like, at that corner building, you probably know it, 105 Marsh Street, they'd like to have a church at that property. The regulations state that when a use variance is being proposed to the Zoning Board of Appeals, it has to come before the Planning and Zoning Commission. It does not require a vote. However, if you want to make any comments on it, you're welcome to, and those will be presented at the ZBA meeting in the public hearing.
It does seem like it's not too often that we see something like this. So it's a use variance only comes
correct
for our comment if we care?
Correct.
Thank you. And I'll offer a comment that it certainly works for me. It's a nice piece of property that I think goes underutilized.
I will say the applicants are here in case you have questions for them.
Oh, okay. Thank you. George?
Yeah, just a couple little things. Does it meet parking regulations?
Yeah, they're going to have more than enough parking. I think they've got 20 some odd spaces. 22. The regulations state that you need one per every four seats, so they're going to be well over what's required.
Okay, as long as they don't grow two or three times bigger than they are, right?
Right, right.
Okay. Which was the other part of my question.
Okay. Dan?
The other question I had was, is the lighting in the parking lot adequate? Because I see two lights toward the building, sort of, but I assume they take care of the parking lot. It's a relatively modern parking lot.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if you guys have taken a look at the lighting, if that's...
The two posts there, I believe.
Right. Is that enough, in general, you'd say, for night meetings?
So far, landlord's willing to work with us if we could add something more to it, sure.
I don't know if you need more.
I have one question.
Dan?
This is the first time that, since I've been on the board, we've been having an application for what we call a use variance.
Mm-hmm.
And they've always troubled me before I got to the board. But where in the regulations do we have something set out special for use variances different from a variance?
There is. There's a section.
What section is that? I'd like to.
It's 10.4.F.4.
Say this again?
10.4.F.4. It's towards the back.
Page 128.
Okay. Yeah. Let me just take a look.
All right. So if in fact, would this need to have a lighting analysis? Any particular reason why we think that would be necessary?
It's certainly a legitimate inquiry, and we do have light regulations within the zoning regulations that they should be reviewing for compliance. So I have not recently inspected the site in the evening, but traditionally if the use has activities in the evening, we would want to make sure there's adequate lighting in the parking lot and also in the walkways and entrances to the building. So that's certainly a recommendation we can pass on to the ZBA for them to think about. Now, just so you know, this application. If they are not making any significant changes to the property, will not likely be coming to you in the future. It's likely to, depending on what the CBA does, that would be the forum for the review of this application. So if they get a use variance, the use will not be coming to planning and zoning unless they propose changes to the site. If they also propose changes to the outside of the building, the Historic District Commission may have to look at it as well. But my understanding is they're very limited improvements proposed to be made to the property. So if you do have observations, such as George mentioned, probably now would be the time to get them in the record, and we can certainly pass those on to the ZBA.
Do you have an opportunity to read it and got further questions, Dan? No? Okay. Tony?
When Mohawk proposed the office use down there and the dumpsters, we had probably 20, 30 other people come in to testify, other taxpayers on this, and I understand that this use is primarily because it's an agricultural zone. Does that sound right? If it was a residential zone, would there be a hearing for this before anybody? Or
it would be here rather than at the ZBA.
Here before the ZBA.
So as part of the ZBA process, similar to the planning and zoning process, they will be sending notification out to the neighbors within, I think it's the same standard, 300 feet.
There's actually only two neighbors in that 300-foot, technically three. One is the town of Wethersfield. The other two are First Church, the cemetery, and the neighbor across the street. So,
will the Victory Baptist Church be a tax-exempt organization? So it will be taxable, sort of like the church that we have behind the Tilt and Kilt there that took over that commercial office building.
If it remains in private ownership and they lease it, it's taxable. So it depends on the ownership.
49 or 99 years, that could raise an exempt status for the building.
Potentially
under 1281 of the statutes.
Yeah, I'm not sure their lease terms are going out 99 years, so 2 years.
The other concern is, you know, we went through last year, I think, the snowplow equipment being stored on the site, and how that was a little bit of a lengthy night just by having a couple of yellow trucks in the backyard and all, and I don't think we're going to see that. This is a facility that's under 50 seats, I think, inside the facility. I think I counted 47. The site itself, I think, has potential for more expansion and more utility. It is a gateway to the community, mm-hmm. to drive through, and I think even if potential expansion does come down the road and it does come before us, I think it's still, with compliment, you know, based on all the layers of oversight, would still be a positive effect. And with that question in mind, just because we've had, since I've been on there, I think there's 4 or 5 church reviews that we've had at different levels and different capacities. If they wanted to expand on this, that would be required to, like any church property, if they acquired adjacent properties or whatever, it would definitely have to come before us. I think you said that.
It might need to go back to the ZBA, I would think, and then it might, it definitely would come to you for the expansion.
And that's like that for all churches. If anybody acquired additional lots or additional acreage, it has to have full and complete exposure with mailing notices to.
Definitely with the Planning and Zoning Commission. Many other zones permit churches. It's just that the agricultural zone does not permit much in the way of use activity. So it has limits in terms of what's permitted. We had talked to the owner at one point in time about, you know, coming in and rezoning it. He has not pursued that option. So the agricultural zone presents limitations to develop property.
It seemed to me, because I was here when we voted on the agricultural zone, but the point is that I didn't think these kind of areas were in. I thought it was mostly
this,
except for south of Maple Street, the stuff north of it were not in the agriculture.
There was a stream channel encroachment line that sort of bisects the historic district, and this is on the river side of it. That encroachment line, from a regulatory point of view, was disbanded some years ago. So it's probably at some point in time we should have a conversation about whether there are other properties that are in a similar situation that we might want to revise the, that line now, because it really means nothing anymore. And this would be one of those properties that probably, but the option would be to make it residential probably. And I mean, if it was residential, actually the church would be permitted. It would be a special permit, but it would be permitted, so.
Another question, Mr. Chairman, kind of relates to this and this. I was surprised that the Mohawk, or who was it that had it for 3 years, used that building?
For the construction office for the bridge, yeah.
I thought that was turned down.
They came in also for a trailer. They wanted to use a construction trailer. That was the opposition.
Okay, thank you.
It's coming back.
Yeah.
It's coming back.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't want them turning out from old, well, you know, from the green against this.
So what else? So Peter and or Denise will draft a letter doing what?
So the comments I have are limitations on seating, take a look at the lighting, confirm that the parking is adequate. I haven't looked at the pavement condition, but that's also something typically, you know, we would ask ZBA in just general to do, since it's not coming here, to do a full site plan review and look at all of the things that you would look at. Maybe I would defer to Justin to have him do that as part of his staff memo. You know, I don't think there are any sidewalk down there that we would, you know, we would look at a lot of different things. So I think maybe that's the recommendation. If there isn't a strong feeling about the use going in there, then we should just advise ZBA if they're going to look at it in a positive way to make sure all the other, you know, traffic control. I think that driveway exit, there were some restrictions on it years ago. We may, you know, so all of those things should be kind of factored into the to the review as we would, as you guys would do that.
Okay.
in lieu of you having you do it.
Okay, sounds good.
When the ZBA approves this, does it follow it in perpetuity? If this church leaves, another church can come in?
Typically, unless they do what you do, which would be to attach a time frame and have it renewed at some point down the road. So once again, that's subject to their decision making. But yeah, if it was just granted without those limitations, it would run with the land, and another church, if they wanted to do similar activities and under similar rules, could go in there.
Good. Anything else?
And also, when it comes before the zoning board, is that a public hearing?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
So that if someone did have an issue with it, they could come forward at that time.
They would have a forum to voice those concerns, yes.
No trailers, then.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, just one thing, that people can come before, but they can't oppose the use. It's basically, you know, the way the building looks.
That's
or
true.
The design.
That's
or
true.
The things of that nature, because we were granting a use variance for it.
So the zoning board would only address the use. Is that what you're saying,
we're,
Dan?
No. What we're doing is we're addressing the use of the.
No,
We're not. We're not voting, or we're just.
No, recommending. That's true.
Or just giving comments.
You're right. I'm sorry.
Really just
we're recommending only.
Yeah, we're just giving constructive comments.
Yep. I'm sorry. I take that back.
Okay.
Yep.
All right. George?
Question. On the parking question, which I asked earlier, and they don't anticipate being so large that they'd have to have more parking, but it could be provided down there at some future date if necessary. That is a bad site and location for people trying to park off-site. Like, and I know they would probably try to park in the town garage area, probably, but that's still across a very busy roadway, street, Marsh Street. And so that would concern me, but that's a future issue, of course, but they ought to be concerned, at least think about it. I don't know what they could do. And I don't think there's any other solution to that. But I wouldn't want people walking down that street or walking across it.
Justin's already satisfied that. I don't think we're going to have a Church of the Latter-day Saints like they have in Farmington when you drive out that way and that location. So it is restricted based on the size of the building and the size of the site.
All right. Shall we move on to the next topic? Good luck with that. Item 4.2, a discussion regarding air conditioners and generator setbacks. Good old Justin, at it again.
You're hearing a lot from me tonight, huh?
Sorry.
So this is something that comes up fairly often. You know, in my capacity as zoning officer, I deal with a lot of inquiries from the public about where things can go on their property, how people can use their property, all that type of stuff. And a very common question that I always get is, where can my air conditioner go? Where can my generator go? Well, currently, and the way it's always been interpreted by previous zoning officers with the town, is that air conditioners and generators have to follow the principal setbacks for the structure. So what that means is, if you're in the AA zone and you're required to have 15 feet on each side of your property, your air conditioner cannot go closer to the property line than 15 feet. It's my most regular variance topic with the ZBA. I think I've had four this year, four air conditioners, and I think another one for a generator. So a lot of people have asked, you know, why, what's the purpose behind this? Why does this have to follow the principal structure setback, but I can build a garage as close as 5 feet to the property line? And I thought it was somewhat of a valid question, so I figured I'd bring it before you guys, try to get some thoughts, see if it was something that you'd maybe look favorably upon amending, and if so, how? And yeah, so I'm just looking sort of for some feedback. And you offered
a couple different ways to address it.
Yeah, I gave a few options.
I did.
Basically, we could either say that they're accessory structures, and that way they can be as close as 5 feet to the property line, or we have a section called typical projections. It's in italicized on the second page of my memo. Did these print in color or no?
Yeah, no color, but that's okay.
No color. Okay, well, there were a couple words added. They were in red originally.
The second paragraph on the second page, so the second, the middle of the second line where it begins air conditioning, condenser units, and standby generators, that was added. The rest of it is the existing text, I'm assuming?
That's right, yep.
You just say chimneys may extend into the required.
So chimneys is there, but then air conditioning, condenser units, and standby generators.
Mm-hmm.
Simply, I'm not going to talk a lot. I think we should do it. That one. Fine.
That's all you have to say?
That's all.
That's all right.
All right.
I mean, if we think it's really necessary, and obviously we're not doing it, four doesn't sound like a lot, but yeah, I mean, the new added language in the paragraph would seem to be the better option. I don't like the idea of being able to put it all the way to the 5 foot offset, and they're noisy. I actually thought they had to always be in the backyard.
I do have a question, Mr. Chairman.
You said you were done.
Long into planning and zoning here and at the state level, so I asked the question. You think as a planner I would know this, but what is the purpose of side yards? My feeling is, living in town and so forth and being on this commission and my own home, that getting down to side yards is what they're there for, the width, and sort of, in my mind.
One reason anyway, yeah.
One of the main reasons. And these pieces of equipment can be moved if necessary. So I also thought of that while going through this. They're not a permanent part of any structure. So in your thinking.
But they are.
Not
that they wouldn't.
Moving a 3-ton air conditioner.
Yeah, right. I mean, they would impede access around the back with a piece of equipment.
Well, and that's why I lumped it in sort of with the chimney concept. A chimney's not going anywhere.
Right. No, I'm with you.
You're not moving that. But the air conditioning condenser, standby generator, it's the same. To me, it almost seems like the same type of utility that's being provided with it.
So, Justin, some of our zones allow 5-foot setbacks.
Correct. What we have, the smallest requirement is a 5-foot one side and a 15-foot aggregate setback.
So in the scenario where you have 5 feet on one side and 10 feet on the other side, how would this rule apply? You could go 3 feet to the property line then?
Correct.
Okay.
That would be in our B and C residential zones.
So you could get down with the, yeah.
Right.
With a truck or a light truck, yeah.
But it wouldn't be ADA accessible. But anyways, go ahead. Yeah, Tony.
This issue came up about 6 months ago with, I think we had about 12 waterfront communities from Fairfield County through New London County, primarily in reaction to Hurricane Sandy. FEMA regulations are extensive, and again, it's secondary to the fact of the details here. And granted, the sideline does make sense, but the noise issue has been turned into a huge quarrel on most of the Long Island Sound communities. These houses are raised anywhere from 4 to 9 feet. The homes are teardowns. They become McMansions, where you might have one compressor. Now there's 4 or 5 next to each other. And when you put these air conditioners on a sideline within 5 feet, which is 10 feet away from another house, 8 feet in the air, it faces most people's bedrooms next door. And I think if we could ask for a little more research and maybe filter through on some of the other communities, not just on the sideline issue and the aesthetics of it, but primarily on the noise issue.
Size, capacity, noise.
You're going to hear a significant amount of litigation occurring, and it encroaches not only on the zoning enforcement officers, but the building officials are involved and the health departments are involved. There was some obscure state statute with the building code that does have a noise, a sound amount, and with some of these larger homes that are coming in. Grant, I don't think we're going to have a lot of 6,000 to 8,000 square foot homes coming into to Wethersfield, but I think the location in the noise issue is significant.
And the baffling you can't put up to protect.
If you're within 10 feet, some of them it's become quite aggressive for some of the waterfront towns. So that's just one observation for tonight. I'd like to do a little more research from my side. I'll put some calls in too, and
sure,
refer anything over to your office.
Thank you.
The only thing is, I agree with you, but where we are in Wethersfield, the size of the units that are going to be serviced, the homes that we have in Wethersfield, the difference between 8 feet or 5 feet is not going to make any difference noise-wise. I mean, it shouldn't, anyway. I wouldn't think it would make, you know, that much difference.
Generally doesn't, but I know over, I think it was on Greenfield Street, where one of my neighbors was saying that they installed central air and the other one didn't. In the hot days of summer, when the pool's opening up across the street, and that compressor clicks on, you know, the guy was working second shift, and he had his windows open and the screens in, you know. It was just enough to startle him, and it caused a little tension in the neighborhood. I don't know where that resolved, and it was just something, either Greenfield or Hillsdale or one of my neighbors.
Well, what I will say is...
It's a nominal issue, though, Dan, I agree with you.
When people ask me, you know, why it has to follow that setback, the noise is what I usually bring up, because it's, you know, especially with the generator, you know, you're hearing some noise from that. But one of the sort of ironies is it with the setbacks is if you install like an in-ground pool or an above-ground pool, the pump and the filter, no matter what lot you're on, because the accessory structure can go as close as 5 feet to the property line. So you could have your pool pump on one of our bigger lots 5 feet from property line, but your air conditioner can't be closer than 15 feet. So one of the little ironies associated with it.
I also see a difference between air conditioners and generators. The generators are noisy. I mean, mostly people use generators in case of an emergency, but that's not necessarily always has to be the case.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that maybe we want to take into consideration that there is a difference between regulation relating to generators. I'm more concerned about approving air conditioners than I am generators.
And air conditioners are the far more common issue.
It's more common, they're less noisy, mm-hmm. more people have them, they're more, you need them.
Right.
A generator is more, I look at it as an emergency situation, which is good, put it out in your backyard or something, but not in your side yard, because that is awfully noisy. That's tough.
Yeah.
And
those are noisy, and I think the reason I include it is, like you said, you're typically not running it unless you don't have power, in which case you have bigger issues to worry about. But you know, that's why I brought this to you guys. I wanted to get your feedback, see where it was going to go.
So if we approve a generator in a side yard, they need to provide an outlet for the guy next door so they can have free power.
That works.
He's my friend when we're out of power for 5 days.
Well, generators have become much more common.
I mean, yeah, they will in the future.
You're going to become standard.
Right, and they have a... You know, the recycle, right? So once a month or something, they often kick on by themselves, right? And that kind of thing. So
has that been an issue with the building department or with your offices in Wethersfield, generators?
In terms of noise?
Installation and locations?
Yeah, well, we always look on a plot plan to see where it's going to be placed.
And the five-foot is required versus a two-foot?
Correct, correct. In some cases, the last one that sparked this off, I just talked to her a week or two ago, and she wanted to put in a generator on the side yard line. She wanted it for the winter, elderly couple, I guess, and she had some concerns about her husband's health. And I said, well, you can't put it there without a variance. And of course, the variance starts the whole, we only meet once a month aspect. And then by the time you apply, you're talking January already. So it's an added hassle for people that we may be able to help some people out with an amendment.
So I honestly thought this was going to be more of a slam dunk, but so we'll talk about it again next time. Do a little more. Is that what?
Noise issues related to any of the other other towns. So
I think checking with the building inspector, probably finding out how many we issue, and then, you know, I think you guys made quite a few valid points that need a little bit of research and.
Sure.
And we would have to approve it formally.
It would have to go through the regulation amendment process, public hearing, you know. There was somebody who might have showed up tonight.
Yeah, that was the elderly woman.
To speak in support of making the changes, but obviously she wasn't able to make it. So so there is some community interest in this as well.
Yep. Is it possible that we should do a special? So next spring,
yeah, it's just instead of a complete permitted use, because you don't know about the size that a person wants. So if it's allowable, that we should be a special permit use, only because it would give a right to somebody to review it, whether it be ZBA or ourselves, somebody to review it in case it's this gigantic type of machine, that which is really going to cause problems, just to keep some kind of control.
It goes up over 3 ton or something like that, bigger homes.
I think maybe our research will bring back some information, but yeah, there might be some limits I think we want to put in here that, you know, if you're going to allow something closer, it can't be over a certain BTUs or whatever the terminology is. But I think that was one of the notes I made, that we may have to be a little more specific on what we allow and what, you know, what we don't allow.
And probably the bigger air conditioners would be on the larger lots in the community, the more expensive homes. And
for somebody who likes it really cold inside,
could be, you know, more. You could add a percentage distance.
We've got a couple lots where the houses fill up the whole.
Yeah,
right. Fill up. That's what I'm thinking. Right. Yeah, you could have a pretty
and
big house
right next to each
lot,
other,
right?
With, you know, windows and, you know, looking at neighbors and things like that. So
old Wethersfield.
Right.
Well, and that's sort of, that may be an issue, especially coming up with the whatever subdivision back lane, the subdivision. Mm-hmm. A lot of the site plans that I've seen, although they're preliminary, they are going sort of right up to the setbacks.
Yep, and, squeezing in.
You know, especially on the sides, if you're looking to put an air conditioner in,
not a big house.
I might be getting a lot of variances in the future. So.
Okay. Good discussion. I guess we're on to the minutes, unless anybody's got anything else, right? So there are two sets of the minutes. I think we may have problems here. Let me look quickly. Myself, Tony, one. Two, three.
I wasn't here at both of these.
Four, five. Well, we do have, we have five. We have five who were at the first one, and I don't know that we're going to have enough on the next one.
What are you talking about, the minutes?
Because Yolanda wasn't at the second one.
Not for November 1st.
Let's take care of October 4th.
Make a motion to approve October 4th.
Did you take a peek at them there? This is the one where we were talking about the I want to say trailers, mobile homes,
RVs and
RVs,
such.
Et cetera. So I looked it over. It looks good. Are you making a motion to approve?
Yeah, I made a motion to approve. I didn't find
it. And I'll second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So again, there were only five of us here. It's myself, Tony Marsh, George Oikle, Dan, and Yolanda. Mm-hmm. All right, but that's enough for that one. And again, is anybody seeing it differently? We do not have enough here to take care of the next one. All righty? So we'll
move to
save that one table for the next one?
Yeah. I move to approve the minutes of November 1st.
So we don't have enough people. We don't have enough people who are there.
We don't have enough people there.
Yeah.
No.
All righty, so we'll wait till the next time. What else? Is that it on the agenda?
Just a couple things under staff report. So we are still working on the RV regulations, boat regulations. It has generated some level of community, I wouldn't say concern, but curiosity about what we're going to do with those regulations. There are a, there's a long list of people in the community who have boats, RVs, trailers that the regulations would impact. I just want to, before we, I'm still going to come back and give you some, you know, additional, I need some additional direction on certain aspects of it, so we're not quite there yet. But I don't know if you want to have some sort of a community forum or put it on an agenda and let, I'm not sure exactly how we would let the community know about this. We don't have a really good mechanism to get the word out about things like that, but nevertheless, it may, I would hate to get to the point of finalizing it, having an actual public hearing on the specifics, and then having a bunch of people jump up and down who didn't have an opportunity to weigh in on this at an earlier stage in the process. So I just wanted to put that out there. If you wanted to consider something to get that kind of input, you know, before we get too much further along. So I'm just sort of throwing that out there for thought and consideration. We have had very, as you can see, very light agendas, and there's not a lot of, well, there are a couple of things on the horizon, but they may not come in immediately. So, you know, I was thinking on a night that we know it's going to be a very light agenda, you know, such as tonight, we try and advertise to the extent we can. You know, I would do a PowerPoint presentation and sort of give options that we're thinking about rather than, you know, and then see what the general feedback from the community is. That's kind of what I was thinking, but
I don't know that you'll get any feedback until you make a presentation to somebody, but then,
yeah,
you know, even then you may not get anything that night, right? And, you know, I don't know who watches the community TV or how much additional information will go out after your presentation, but I guess I wonder whether it's a combination of, you know, have your hearing and just leave it open and then have another one, you know, two meetings later or something, you know, on purpose.
Okay. Yeah, that might be a scenario.
So you would favor the public forum, which, right?
Well, I think you have to, right?
I think
have to. You're going to change, you're going to propose to change your regs.
You should publicize this
heavily. I don't, and
that's true.
We do it all the time at DOT where we have projects, proposals, right? And there's always this.
Tell them about it ahead of time. And
so it's not, I wasn't going to go so far as to really get into how we publicize it, but it's a matter of the quandary is how much you. No, it's just how much do you go out with? How much information do you go out with without the public thinking you've made all your decisions, mm-hmm. right? But if you don't present them with something, you get garbage for return.
Mm-hmm.
So you really kind of have to do a plan. You have to do a proposal.
Specific proposal, right.
And let them react to it and then do it again, you know? Just going out and what are your thoughts? You'll get nothing back. You'll get one person who wants the 50-footer and think by right and, mm-hmm. and someone else who doesn't want you to even have anything by right. So.
Okay. Yes. Yeah, and I'm not sure it's newspaper story worth. I don't know if I would get a reporter to, you know, write an article. I mean, the Life might, River Minder might, but Hartford Current probably not. So we can certainly do that. But as I say,
always call us when we turn something down.
That's true. That's true.
Or so when we approve it, and it's in the front yard.
Yeah. So. Right. All right, so we're not at the point yet of doing that, but I wanted to be thinking ahead. So I'm still researching a few things, and I'll be bringing it back to you for further guidance, and then we can maybe talk about that at that point. But I think what you're saying is let's do all that, get a regulation, get an application together, plan on multiple nights of hearings so that we can give people the opportunity to at least review it, get some feedback, and then, I mean, obviously we can tweak it as well. I mean, if we get a lot of feedback and people really are opposed to what we're, you know, we can still either roll it back or we got to be careful about bumping it up and making it, you know, too much more lenient, but nevertheless.
I'll tell you, I did get some comment from the public, a couple of people. People do watch it on TV, and indicated that if we're going to do something, we probably should, because it's not fair for the people that we've denied permits to, that we should move on it. So I'm just going to bring that up.
Okay. All right. And then I did send you an email. It was only a couple days ago, so if you haven't had a chance to think about this, that's fine. But I'd sent you an email that the town manager is looking for some feedback on the high school project and the rooftop mechanical situation. As I said in the email, they have painted some of the bigger units a kind of a tan beige color, in an effort to see how that looks and what the reaction is. There was a condition on your approval for the high school that, you know, they come up with a plan to screen the rooftop units. At the time they submitted for planning and zoning approval, they had not sized the units. They had not located the units on the roof. Obviously, the units are there now. So I know there's you know, only half of you here, so maybe we need to wait in case there are others who have some thoughts on this. But nevertheless, they're looking for some guidance on whether the paint is going to do it alone, or whether it's the paint in combination with some other screening, whether it's, you know, physical or something else. And I've gotten a couple of emails. Tom Dean's email comes to mind. So for those of you who are here and you want, and you've had a chance to look at it, I'd be happy to get your input and I'll pass it back on to the town manager.
Where exactly are these units?
Well, they're units all over the roof, and they're visible from different streets. And J Street, Wolcott Hill is the primary entrance.
You can see them everywhere.
You can see them everywhere, the side streets. So, it's not just the units that they've painted. There are other units that are, and we did, just to be fair and consistent, we did have a lengthy discussion, and it's still not resolved with the magnet school, the correct magnet school. They put walls on the roof to screen those units. So just to keep that in mind.
Yolanda, you had an email and you suggested screening. Did you have anything more to say?
No, I think I was just following up with your email. I did take a drive by today, and it was pretty noticeable, and it did look very industrial. So I don't know what kind of screening you provide. I do want to drive by the Creek. Is that the one on Silas Dean?
The Creek is the one off of Cumberland, up in Tony's Wolcott Hill, Cumberland. If you go down Cumberland, which is connects
the old CL&P,
between Wolcott Hill and Folly Brook.
Okay.
If you go down that street, that's where their bus lane is, and they've got, as they say, they're not completely done, but you can go into the parking lot too and just do a loop, and you can see the other side as well.
Okay. Because you indicated that the architect had some ideas too for the
apparently
screen,
they do. He hasn't shared those with me in terms of what he's thinking about doing to screen them and, you know, combine with the paint. So I guess I'm just looking to hear if the paint helps, but if it's not complete, then, you know, I need to tell them they need to come in with more than just a paint solution. So I think that's really the
And then
we'll see what they propose to do, because there are technical limitations probably on what they can put on the roof given the size and the wind loads and, you know, costs and other factors. So
I haven't seen it, but, you know, the two people that have responded that that's probably not good enough, right? So that's probably going to give you an indication, right? You might as well tell them to start thinking about something else. But Mr. Dean's comments I thought were kind of appropriate in terms of, you know, I don't know how much they can do without messing up their roof.
Right.
You know?
You don't want to draw more attention to it with some other kind of structure up there.
So I just throw that out.
I drove by it, and I agree. I think something has to be done. I don't think the paint's sufficient. And
three for three.
I'm more inclined to not do anything, hoping it would be a low profile of a look, but these are saluting way up high. This is a beacon in our community, and they've done an amazing, wonderful job in that high school. I think it's absolutely gorgeous. It's a shame that the eyesore is there. Because you know me, I'll back off if it seems like it's not cost effective and it's not a capital expenditure, but I think something has to be done.
Has the building committee looked at that at all?
The building committee was the group that suggested initially the paint to see how that The paint was kind of a, you know, experiment, trial balloon to see what, you know, let's paint it, see how it looks, see if it looks better than it did before. So I think that was their first, but I know the architect is, has given some thought to other solutions. As I say, I can't comment on those because I haven't seen what that is yet.
What was there before? I don't recall, excuse me. What was there before? Was it a smaller unit?
There were smaller units in different places. Yeah, it's a lot bigger. Those are all brand new. They just changed everything. So it's probably a good thing. They probably should show you what was there before. I'm sure they've got pictures of that somewhere that they can use as a before and after to see what the...
Just to see what the difference is.
Right,
right. I never noticed it before.
Right.
And again, I wasn't looking at the roof. But, you know, when you drive in...
Well, it's the combination with the road elevation is up here, and it looks right at the... And then it comes down, so...
Right. We don't live there either. I mean, in the neighborhood. So it's, I drive in to pick up my grandson, but I'm not looking at the roof. I'm just
Correct. In
and out.
The town manager has asked that if we... if this does come before you, that we notify the neighbors within 300 feet to give them an opportunity to also weigh in. I know a couple of them have attended the building committee meetings and have weighed in with their concerns. So there will be the opportunity for the public to weigh in, depending on, no matter what the end, because they were obligated as a condition of approval to provide a screening plan, and I'm not comfortable handling that just at the staff level, so I would want the commission to bless that. So
the architect might have a quick fix.
He might.
He might. So let's
let
it play out.
That's what they pay them the big bucks for. You know, those high paid consultants. You know that they need to.
But we've tended to screen whenever we got into these kind of things in the past a few times. We actually put up screen.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Of some sort.
Yeah. It's not the first time we've had to deal with these.
Interesting, our colleague, who's not here tonight, how he feels about it. He probably has to deal with a lot of this down in New Haven. Mm-hmm. And the impact that has on the future of the building.
Yeah, yeah, it's a case-by-case, you know, yeah, situation. So sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes you need it, sometimes...
I didn't get a chance to look at it, and I will talk to you in the next few days after I do.
Yep, okay. And then the last thing is to remind you that at your next meeting, we are planning, or at least I'm still waiting to hear, but we are planning, and we're trying to coordinate a pre-application review on the fun zone redevelopment. We have let the design review, inland wetlands, town council members all know about it. So if they want to attend, and it'll be unusual as to how you want to handle that, but I think the purpose of it is to get everyone's commentary on that. So it's not a public hearing. We're not advertising it to the larger community, but we've invited those boards and commissions under the theory that we didn't want to make the developer go to four different night meetings with these various boards and commissions. If they're going to be here, let's invite everybody. So we'll have to figure out a mechanism to allow them, if they have some thoughts, to provide those thoughts to the developer. So, you know, I defer to the chairman as to how you want to handle that. But the next meeting is the 6th of December. So hopefully you can clear your calendars for that, and we can get a good turnout and provide them with some good feedback on the plan that they're going to present.
Will we be getting any information?
Yeah, you'll get I've given them a couple deadlines that they have to meet, so you'll get a full-blown information packet with, I'm thinking, color renderings of the building. I mean, we met with them, you know, a couple weeks ago, and they had some pretty decent information at that point. So I think by the time, you know, you get it, it'll be even further refined. So you'll get it in a similar way to you get your normal packets. So, but they will also obviously have a full-blown presentation the night of the meeting, so.
Although it will be a preliminary.
It's a pre-application. Pre-application, yeah.
And you were looking for input from us with respect to how the other commission, other boards?
No, your things. I'll let the Wetlands Commission, you know, comment on their areas of, but we wanted that opportunity.
So on the night of the meeting, how we.
Yeah, we just got to figure out, you know, if maybe we'll have the design review wear blue shirts.
Yeah, okay.
And Wetlands green.
Green, obviously.
Something like that. I don't know, town council, I don't know, I won't say what color.
Not inviting them, are we?
Yeah, they, yeah, so. So we'll have to figure that out logistically, and so that's where the wrinkle is, that, you know, we haven't really done that before. We've talked about having these, you know, joint meetings, but this.
You said you thought at one point there was a technical problem with.
Quorum issue?
I did, inland wetlands has never done it before. The statutes allow them to do it, so I did ask the town attorney about the appropriateness of it, and he was okay with that, and we forwarded that on to the wetlands chairman. Hopefully, since we've invited them, they will attend, but it's unusual for them, and it, as Rich indicated, I don't think they have to do their own agenda and post, you know, their attendance as a special meeting. It's just a planning and zoning meeting, so as long as we do that, it should cover the other boards and commissions.
So as.
As of now, we have a light agenda, or would that be the only item on the agenda for that?
What about the home occupation? Okay, so right now, it's the only, it's really the only thing. So we've tried to clear the agenda so that.
Do you think this could be a potentially a lengthy evening? And I ask because I don't know if we wanted to do the, if you have anything like a PowerPoint presentation with a boat and trailers and.
No, I think I just, we've tried to clear the agenda for this. I mean, you know, they want to make a full blown. If you remember the presentation on, I think on the First Ridge Road where they had, you know, all sorts of stuff. You know, these guys have architects, they have a team of people, and I think they'll want to use the technology of the room, in the room with the, you know, PowerPoints and all that kind of good stuff. So
it's worthy of.
Yeah, I think of any.
Focus.
Yeah, I think it is. It's a big project, and they are going to be asking for some, you know, your regulations allow some modifications, so they're going to be asking for some of those. So I think it's important that you understand what they're asking for, and if there's some strong feelings about it, they need to hear that so that, you know, they can go back if they have to the drawing board on some of those requests. It's obviously not you're not making any decisions, but I think it's important, and we've stressed this before, that if they're going to come in for the pre-application, you need to be frank and honest and direct with them and tell them, you know, if you don't like aspects of it, or if you think it's too high, or it's too, you know, this is the time to tell them that, so that they don't go to all the final engineering and then and I know you're not, you know, it's not a vote, and you know, it's non-binding, but you know, if you know, if you feel.
It's critical in the direction and how much they want to commit.
Yes.
How far
exactly
they want to go with it.
Exactly.
And I'm excited about it.
Yeah.
What was the use again?
It's a mixed use. So it's residential apartments with commercial retail restaurant type space on the first level. But it's a, you know, it's a higher density, and, you know, it's a little different than what you've seen before. So and it's, you know, it's close to a $30 million project, so it's a big investment, and I think they, you know, they're going to be looking for some serious guidance. And so, you know, if there are aspects of it you feel strongly about, they need to hear that. So,
you know, it was nice at the Ridge Road project to have half a dozen other comparable marketplace comparisons, anyway, on it, be it West Hartford or Farmington, and some of the others. Is it? It gave a little more clarity, and we had to go through two or three meetings to get to that point. It'd be nice to have that come right out of the gate, too, on where the model's coming from and what their intent is.
Yeah, they have done, this developer has done some recent projects in Glastonbury and Windsor and downtown Hartford, so he can point specifically to things. I don't know that any one of them in particular matches this particular model, but nevertheless, you can get a sense for you know, some of his work elsewhere, and I think he will have some of that in the in the package that you get, so that if it's only going to be a couple days, but you know, there's one he did the project in Windsor Center by the rail station. It's apartments. They're just, I don't know, so if anyone gets up to Windsor between now and then, that's one that comes to mind. There's a mill project in Glastonbury, I'm trying to think of the name of it. But we can get you some of that stuff in advance, so that if you want to go out and take a look at his projects elsewhere, we can do that.
So we kind of danced around the date, the second meeting in December is on the 20th. You kind of, I heard you say that somebody else is waiting until January. Is there typically a second meeting in December?
Yes.
It's the 20th?
It's scheduled for the 20th.
Okay.
But if we don't, we can talk about that the next meeting. If we don't have any applications, then there would be no real need to meet.
We don't have applications, I don't want to come.
There you go, okay. Or we could have the...
Lights will be out, nobody will be here but me.
We could have the first annual Homicki Christmas extravaganza. That's, maybe we can do that. A new tradition.
We're sitting with my punch.
All right, if there's nothing else, you're good? Nothing else, is there a motion to adjourn?
So move.
Thank you, Dan. And thank you, Tony. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Well done, didn't mean to distract you.
Oh, no, that's fine, that's why. Work your magic.